Thank you very much, to the organizer, for inviting me to this virtual meeting. I will give this virtual seminar. So I'll talk about starting inflation in an homogeneous universe using what seems a novel connection to mathematics. Now, both Victor and I were asked to talk about lambda for the fourth infinite space, and we coordinated with Victor that we would talk about this. And this is a subject matching theme with the conference, which is about correlation functions in inflation density space. Here instead, I will talk about something more on the side, but I think it's still important, is that how we get in the universe to the density space. Instead of assuming that we have the density space or inflation, how do we get to that? In fact, for a long, and I think this is important to say that we're studying something that is ample physical motivation. Now, for a long time, there was much debate about how likely is for inflation to start. This is often called the initial patch problem. In fact, it was believed that it was very unlikely out of inhomogeneous initial conditions for inflation to start. I believe that what is called this initial patch problem is in practice solved. And the way it was solved is that we show that it is not existent, but not for trivial reasons, for what at least are to me subtle reasons. In fact, we realized that we could use the same codes that are used by the people who do produce the templates for LIGO, and they can simulate black hole mergers to simulate a universe which starts completely homogeneous. This is a completely inhomogeneous initial condition. Rho is very inhomogeneous, changes by four orders of magnitude in this plot here. Look at the legend here. And this is a would-be inflationary Lagrangian, but with incredibly very highly inhomogeneous initial conditions. On a torus, on periodic boundary condition, we let it go. Singularities will form, but we have codes that can handle singularities. And what we found is that, okay, inflation starts, you see. No, sorry, the universe starts evolving. And that the overdensity seems to accumulate at the same place, growing, growing, growing. In fact, at some point, it becomes very dark and actually a black hole. Indeed, now we excise the black hole. But all the rest, there is white region. White region means that the density is the same as the density of a cosmological constant or the inflation of potential energy. And therefore, inflation starts. So we ran several simulations like this, and we always found that inflation starts somewhere in this universe. Indeed, actually, for this initial condition, actually, even in most places. I think, obviously, given that we use numerical simulation, we can only use a limited set of initial conditions. But in our paper, we also provide an intuitive argument why the initial conditions we consider are very broad and why this is expected to be. What we found is expected to be a general phenomenon. And in fact, we get lots of singularities, just saw a black hole. So how more inhomogeneous one we should be? It's pretty good that we're starting with very inhomogeneous initial condition. In fact, you will notice, say, we can look at the simulation when after one Hubble time and the universe is contracting some places, expanding somewhere else. So it's pretty complex and seems that the inflation provides always starts. In fact, other groups that I cannot mention, but Eugene Lim, Raphael Flauger, and others have produced similar results. And now, as I said, the reason why this result could be obtained and could not be obtained like 20 years ago is because there were not available the codes, or even 10 years ago, probably the codes that could handle singularity were not available. Still, in the same paper, we also discover and explain a new problem that could be associated to how to start inflation, therefore to end out of inhomogeneous initial condition, therefore to end up with a universe, a sitter or inflation-like epoch in a universe, which is associated to the fact that inflation might not start if the inflaton is not entirely contained in the inflationary region of the potential. Now, this is not the initial patch problem. In fact, it is very model dependent. If inflation starts or not starts depends how steep is the end of inflation, how much you touch the inflaton goes also in the region where there is not an inflationary potential. While the initial patch property state was really model independent, was a general feature, in fact, because it was dictated basically by gravity, the problem at least. And in fact, this other problem about is solved in many ways. For example, long field range for inflationary region could be okay, smooth exit. It's really very model dependent. So I do not consider this a worrisome problem, but it is there. And in a sense, it prefers large field range than small field range. But I think the big problem that there is, I found very, 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 very intuitive, very suggestive that there is an initial patch problem for inflation, to me, is not existent anymore. However, when we ran the simulation, we found that inflation was always starting. And so, therefore, we conjectured that actually inflation was always starting. And maybe in terms of, and try to prove it analytically. And this is maybe it's better to do as an approximation to the main problem, to imagine there is a cosmological constant plus another matter, completely homogeneous, and to ask if one starts with an initial expanding universe, which is also the simulation we ran, we're always initial expanding universe, an initial slice, initially everywhere expanding universe, you let the universe go, imagine there is a completely homogeneous matter, but also a positive cosmological constant with the universe reach the city space at late time. This is a pretty good approximation, I find, of inflation, of the universe, in homogeneous universe with inflation. And indeed, here in this talk, we're going to prove a theorem that there is it's called the De Sitter-Noether theorem. That is, we go to the asymptotic that the universe looks like De Sitter. For cosmology, we prove it under the assumption that there is a symmetry in the universe, that there is an isometric group that forms two-dimensional orbits. This is the mathematical way, as I say, that there are two translational symmetries. Now, this idea actually was conjectured. Clement and I conjectured it recently, but then we discovered that there was already conjectured a long time ago by Hawking. And it's typical with many conjectures, it needs to be refined to be right. And I think maybe the one we conjecture is right, that is all initially expanding universe with lambda bigger than zero. And with the right topology, we reach the space. That is, not all topologies will have of the space, or the spatial slice will reach, must reach the city space, but for some topology, in particular for most topology, we think it will be the case. And already Wald in 1983 proved that such a form of conjecture for completely homogeneous universes. It shows that if the dominant energy condition is preserved, all homogeneous but anisotropic universes, which are called Bianchi universes, that are not closed, these non-Bianchi type 9 universes, they cannot recollapse. Dominant energy condition means that this vector here, where the stress tensor is contracted with a time-like or null vector k mu, is future directed. This basically says that the matter doesn't move faster than the speed of light. This implies, for example, the weak energy condition, which means that density is that this contraction with the stress tensor is positive, which means that the energy density is positive. And also, we use the following theorem, the following assumption that the strong energy condition holds, that is, this contraction is true. This is in physical terms, this means that the gravity, the effect on gravity of matter is to make gravity attractive. So Wald proved this theorem in the T3, but extended to an homogeneous case is much more challenging for technical difficulties because the differential equation becomes passed from being ordinary to partial differential equations, so much harder mathematically. And physically, we expect in general singularities to form, geodesics to cross, so it is a huge less symmetric situation. And we will see that we, at least in some settings, we will reach the same conclusion. So let's therefore try to consider the general cosmologies beyond the homogeneous case. And so the manifolds that we're going to consider are the manifolds that I think are interesting for physical reasons, which are cosmologies, which are by definition connected 3+1 dimensional space times. And we will restrict ourselves to the compact Cauchy surface because this allows for a simple mathematical treatment. Now, this is the natural thing, the natural assumption to make that this is space-time. In fact, Gerak in the 70s shows that the space-time is topologically equivalent to R cross M, where M is a trimanifold. And this space-time can be formulated with a family of topological identically Cauchy surface MT. So MT are the slices of the space-time. Now, we will prove a theorem under the following assumption. First of all, we assume that there is a disk cosmology. Then the second assumption is that matter satisfies the dominant strong energy condition on top of M in lambda bigger than zero. Often, these energy conditions are a bit regarded with some skepticism. But in my opinion, the skepticism is associated with the fact that often the cosmological constant does not satisfy them. And also quantum level on small distances, they are violated. But here, the problem is essentially semi-classical, so quantum correction are negligible. And for what concerns the cosmological constant is extracted out, and the normal matter does satisfy this energy condition, apart from the cosmological constant. So we extract out the cosmological constant. I think this is, it seems to me this is a very reasonable setting now. And now we will do to our limitations. A third assumption assuming some symmetry. And we're assuming there is a symmetry group G, which acts on these special manifolds, and says that on the special slices, it says that the induced action on the full space-time is by isometry. This induces isometries on the space-time, and says that the orbits of G are closed surfaces. This is the mathematical ways to say that there are the special slices can be foliated by surfaces who are the orbits, the closed orbits of a symmetry group G. This is what we mean by there is two translational symmetries in a sense. Even though this translational might be non-commuting and things like that. In fact, there are some subtleties we can make actually G act on the universal cover M3. But this, as I said, is what we want to say, that there are homogeneous anisotropic surfaces that foliate the spatial slices. So this is an assumption that unfortunately we do to make progress, but it's already a strong generalization of the homogeneous case. In practice, this means that, for example, you can consider this is a picture of a two-dimensional surface, but here there is circles with there is an isometry here. You should imagine that these circles are two-dimensional surfaces, and then there is a third direction. You see that the federation is foliated by these surfaces, but the federation is not homogeneous. And then we compactify here. So example are three torus, S2 crosses one, S2 mode out with a freely acting group, subgroup, crosses one. There are a pretty large set of manifold that can empty. Basically, but physically means that every time, all the situations where we can impose a bidimensional translational symmetry. And we will prove the following mathematically stated theorem. If the two surfaces have a non-positive Euler characteristic, that is, they're not two spheres, or in the case that they have two spheres, if the initial two spheres are large enough, and also if the initial special slice is expanding everywhere, then asymptotically, the space-time becomes physically equivalent, physically indistinguishable from the city space, a low energy on arbitrary large regions of space-time. This is all true, notwithstanding the presence of initially arbitrary large in density fluctuations. Okay, so this is the theorem that we will prove. And let's set up some notation to prove it. So first of all, we consider some special slice and there is a normal vector. There is a four-dimensional metric, and G mu nu is the three-dimensional metric of the special slices. And the four-dimensional metric is simply related to the three-dimensional metric by this relationship. And there's a Strizzi curve, which is essentially the gradient of this projected gradient of the normal vector, which can be decomposed in an anisotropic part of the Strizzi curve and the anisotropic traceless part. Physically, the Strizzi curve tells you how much the geodesic induced by a mu starting from the surface and the long mu deviates from each other. And if you take the trace, which is called K, Then it tells you how the volume grows, the derivative of the square root of the log, of the log square root of the volume. Sorry, this should be not h, but it should be g, is k. Is k, which means that the volume square root of, sorry, this could be h, but should be g, grows exponentially if k were to be constant. In okay, so this is the Strizzi curvature and the Strizzi curvature of the three-dimensional slices. To make progress in this talk, we need also to talk about the two-dimensional slices, which are particularly symmetric one, and we will consider the vector t mu orthogonal to the special slices. So here, for example, you can consider this line here, which is a two-dimensional surface. We consider how much the surface changes as we move it along the fair direction of the inside the surface. There is a two-dimensional metric h, which is related to the three-dimensional metric by this ratio. And there are this Strizzi curvature, which is called A. This is the standard notation for mathematicians for the Strizzi curvature. Remember, here we have two Strizzi curvature. We have the one on three-dimensional slices in the four-dimensional space-time. And also now we have the two-dimensional Strizzi curvature or the two-dimensional slice into the third, the three-dimensional space. And so this we call A, and the trace we call it H, which looks like the Hubble constant, but the Hubble constant is the Strizzi curvature of three-dimensional slices into four-dimensional. And here he said that they are, is the one, it's not that, here is the one of two-dimensional slices into the third dimension. Okay, and this is some other standard notation mathematician. And okay, so in general, we want to describe these very, very complicated, spaces. And how do we do that? And we assume that there is a manifold which has a solution to the Einstein equation. Of course, the physical solution exists. And we try to understand how, what it is, this geometry. We want to learn as much as possible about this geometry. And to learn about this geometry, we use the mathematical tool, which is called mean curvature flow. The mean curvature flow is, we take a fake surface, a probe surface inside this geometry, and then we'll let evolve, we generate a flow of surfaces by letting evolve this surface according to what is called the mean curvature flow law, which is we move forward, given a surface that will be a Strizzi curvature, which is positive, so if given a three-dimensional surface in the space-time, there will be a positive region with positive Strizzi curvature or negative Strizzi curvature, and we'll move forward in time wherever k is positive, and back in time wherever k is negative, proportional to k. So this generates a flow, and we will learn about the geometry of the space-time by the property of this flow, And notice that since the derivative of the metric is k, or the log of the square root of the metric is k, the change of the volume under this deformation is the integral of the surface of times k squared, because the change is proportional, the amount of we change the metric is proportional to k, but the change in the metric on the normal surface, sorry, I should say that we deform the surface orthogonal, and the orthogonal goes like k as well. So this change goes like k squared. And so the volume grows. So this tells you that there are some very good properties. This gives already an hint that there will be very, very good properties of mean curvature flow that are useful for our setting. And I will now try to explain. In a moment. Notice that already previously, without assumption on any, without any assumption about the geometries, we show that there cannot exist, given this given this situation, there cannot exist a non-singular space-like hypersurface with maximum volume. Given any time slice, there is another slice with larger spatial volume. Furthermore, if the universe is initially expanding everywhere, there must be at least one expanding region on every time slice. And if the lambda is bigger than zero, the expansion rate in that region is bounded from below by that of the city space in flat slices. So this tells you that if you have a universe, I forgot to say here to state the hypothesis, but we meta-satisfied the weak energy condition and for most topologies of the special manifolds, if we start with this, for most topologies of the special manifolds, with initial expanding universe, then the universe cannot recollapse globally, and somewhere it must keep expanding. This, and if there's a positive cosmological constant, that region should expand pretty fast. Now, this suggests that inflation, the universe will reach infinite volume, the inhomogeneity dilutes, and inflation will start, or the city space will be reached, but does not prove it, even though it's a step in the direction. And now, in this paper, we are going to prove it, restricted to the case of two dimensions, assuming that there are two isometries. And we will show, indeed, that if there are two surfaces which have a non-positive Euler characteristic, that is, they're not spheres, S2s, and I can follow the spatial slices, and if we're initially expanding everywhere, then asymptotically, the universe looks indistinguishable from the city space. This holds true notwithstanding arbitrary initial inhomogeneities. Now, we can achieve this reusing mean quadrature flow because there are some intuitive important facts that mathematical fact that we proved in this recent paper to be true, which are intuitive but are mathematically true. And the fact that notice that under me, we take a surface, and it's not obvious that if you deform a surface, this flow that is generated by the deformation will not become singular itself, even though there is no singularity in space-time, but just that the surface become singular and therefore cannot be treated mathematically. This is not the case, and it can be proven that actually the flow stays regular. And the intuitive is because if you have a three-dimensional surface in 3+1 dimensional space-time, this flow tends to make the volume increase because it moves forward in time wherever the surface was increasing, whenever the volume was increasing, and backward whenever it was decreasing. So the new surface is larger volume. But in 3+1 dimensional Lorentzian space, if you have if you try to make a volume larger, in Euclidean space, if you have a codimension one surface, one could make a surface become larger by making like this. Okay, this is longer than a line in Euclidean space. But if the extra dimension, the transverse direction, actually has a different signal, one does like this from here, does like this, the curve becomes null and there is no volume. So this is not good in Lorentzian space. And therefore, actually what wants to do is to stretch as smoothly as possible. So in fact, that's why the flow stays regular. And also, we're assuming that there are the singularities that can form in the space-time. We're allowing for singularity to happen, but they are of the crushing kind. That is, there is a neighborhood where there is a foliation of Cauchy slices where the extrinsic curvature become arbitrarily negative. So this is telling you that physically, we expect that all physical singularities are like this. We don't have any known counterexample where basically the volume goes to zero there. Gravity is attracted, the volume goes to zero there in the singularities. In this case, since the flow, even if the manifold will have a singularity somewhere, one might wonder, okay, the flow does not become singular on itself, but maybe hits the singularity and therefore the differential equation break down. But since the singularities are crushing kind, it can be proven that the flow will not reach those because of this property. Okay, so we proved this, and also we proved the following property on the maximum, that the maximum of the extrinsic curvature, taking the slice, the maximum of the extrinsic curvature, the slice is compact, so there's a maximum. The maximum of the extrinsic curvature is bounded by K lambda, which is the extrinsic curvature, or there will be the city space, plus a small correction. A correction that goes to zero in time. So as time goes on, it converges to this. So the rate cannot be larger than K lambda ultimately. But okay. And let's see what happens. And so the proof of the theorem has several steps. First of all, we show that there is some convergency, some geometric properties, geometric quantities that go to the one that we'd expect in the city space. And these are building blocks to build the equivalence to this space. First of all, we show that on this surface, there will be on this manifold, there will be some minimal surface, say this one. And the area of this minimal surface is close to the one that grows as we grow in the city space, plus or minus a factor of two. Similarly, the transfer length goes also goes the transfer length also goes like stays within a closed factor, say in factor of two. Or, we can make this factor of two arbitrary small in reality, but constant 1.000001. And the length also stays the one that will grow as in the Sitter space, and the volume also grows pretty much like in the Sitter space. And also we can show that the expansion rate of the slices in any point, the expansion rate is on average is almost everywhere the one of the Sitter space. That is the integral over the volume of the difference of the extrinsic curve to respect to square the trace respect to the Sitter one square plus the extrinsic curve to square. This is an integral which is square, integrated over the volume grows, but grows like e to the one third k lambda, while the volume grows like e to the k lambda square. So grows like a line in a sense at most. But given that this quantity, if everywhere k was different by k lambda by constant, or sigma was non-zero by constant, then this will go like the volume. So this tells you that almost everywhere the spatial is the one of the Sitter space. And so this is the first step of the proof. First, we need to prove this. And then, okay, then we know that the universe expands in some average sense, like the Sitter space, the volume, the surface, and the transit length grows like in the Sitter, and the rate is almost the same. And then we focus on the spatial slices, and we say, okay, given that the universe almost expand like in the Sitter space, let's define a model metric ball G, which is the one that we have on the spatial slices at a given time, and let it grow, and let's define it at all time, but let it grow as if it was exact the Sitter space. The idea is that the metric, the true metric, starting late enough time, should be close to this one, because the true metric pretty much expands like the Sitter space. And now the well, in fact we can prove indeed that the sup or the sup of the difference between the metric, the true metric, and this model metric time lambda is smaller than e to the minus 1/6 k lambda square lambda zero, where lambda zero is the time at which this metric, model metric has been defined. Note that this model metric has been defined to be the true metric at time lambda zero, then a subsequent time expanded like in the Sitter space. So at time lambda zero, it is the same as the true metric by construction. So this quantity is zero at times lambda zero, and then later will grow and potentially can grow very much. But you can see that it doesn't grow. I mean, it can grow, but it doesn't grow too much. Indeed, it grows by an amount which is, as you take the time later and later on in the flow, it becomes closer and closer. So of course, and this point-wise, but you already see that this could be as good as it could be, because clearly there are some defects. So at some time, whatever you take, some time, and there is some energy which has been diluted, that cannot be exactly, the matter cannot be exactly the same as in, cannot be exactly the same, the matter, everything cannot be exactly the same as in the space. So the metric cannot grow as in the Sitter space. But the later we start, the less damage this defect do, and there is less thing they can do, and the metric evolves more and more closely to what it is that the Sitter, as you grow in the Sitter space. Okay, so we show that late enough time that the metric becomes close to the one growth with the Sitter space. And then we can now show that these slices at late time become close to the one of the Sitter space, not just the grow like the Sitter space, but they are the one in the Sitter space. That is, we define the metric of the spatial slice, the metric of the spatial slice of the Sitter space in FRW slicing to be the Euclidean metric, the flat space, times e to the two third k lambda square. So this is the scale factor of the Sitter space. So this is a metric in the Sitter space. We don't expect that the full manifold will be, can reach this metric everywhere. Because you see, initially the universe can expand, can have very different, can be very curved, this surface and very different. And then it starts expanding and very different rates. And this, even in the limit, in the hypothesis that everything goes like to the Sitter space, this distance gets stretched, but it doesn't go to zero. So on large, large distances, one expect to see the imprints of what was left out of the initial inhomogeneous conditions. But what we expect instead to be true is that a region gets stretched, and within this region, everything becomes very, very flat and looks like the Sitter space. Therefore, we can define, okay, with this in mind, we define exponential expanding balls. So we take a point sometime here and follow the trajectory of the point along the flow. And around this point, one can define an expanding ball whose radius is growing with time, like the length of the Sitter space, to the Fermi lambda square lambda. And this ball, if you take the initial time of doing this study, later on, much later than the beginning of the universe, as we take this time later than the beginning of the universe, the initial radius of this surface can be very large, arbitrary large. And then within this ball, we can show that the super of the distance between the true special metric and the one of the Sitter space actually become exponentially small in the initial time of observation. Again, because there will be some defect, some little timunu left out, this cannot go to zero. I mean, the metric cannot be exactly equal because they would evolve equally. But the later and later we start, we ask how similar they are, the more and more we can ensure that they are similar. Because by that time, matter is diluted, the gravitational waves are diluted, there is nothing left but the cosmological constant. And so in a sense, this is as good as we could expect. Not much better can happen. So this shows that the spatial slices goes to the one in the Sitter space. What about the full four-dimensional metric? Now the flow, this microwave flow slices naturally define a four-dimensional metric, which is the one that is where we take on the three dimensions we take the spatial slice, the spatial metric, and on the time direction we take this the normal direction to the flow proportional to the extrinsic curvature. Now this is a good metric of space-time because we can prove that the flow actually foliates all the space-time. That is the minimum time of the flow at each. So there will be some time coordinate in this manifold, which we don't know what it is. We don't care too much what it is, but there will be some minimum time. And of each slice, given the slice is compact, will have a minimum time, the time of the original coordinates of the manifold. And we can show that as time goes on, and because of the topology of the space-time, this time is a global time function. So it's defined, is the same time everywhere. I mean, it's defined on the whole manifold. And there's a minimum for this time, height. We call the time the height. There's a minimum time for this slice at each time because the slice is compact. And this minimum time goes to infinity as time goes on. Now, given the fact that the universe is, okay, it goes on. This means that the spatial slices go to infinite volume and also go forward in time and therefore defoliate the whole space time. And okay, that's good. So this metric therefore covers the whole space time in a sense. And at this point we can define the Sitter metric, the true Sitter metric, which is the spatial metric of the Sitter space here and the one of the Sitter space on the time component, which in the lambda time of the flow, it actually has a factor of k lambda square because this flow time is related to t by a k lambda square, a k square, which in the Sitter space will be k lambda square. And now we cannot prove that this metric goes pointwise to this one. We don't prove that without that much further assumptions, but we can prove that. Okay, we already showed that point-wise on an expanding ball, this goes to this, but not on global, on, on arbitrary large regions, we cannot prove on arbitrary large region that this goes to this. So clearly we cannot prove a convergence everywhere because this goes to this only on some expanding ball. In this expanding ball, without assumption, we don't show pointwise conversion of this to this. But there is this fact. So this region is expanding exponentially. So if one consider any null or any time like including null curves, which are the curves that are in particular matter physical system are expected to move on a null or time like geodesics, so which are particular curves, then on any of these curves are inside this ball. Because you see this ball is expanding exponentially and the null curves are most are null, which are less expanding less than that. So they stay within this region. So on this region, this converges to this. And one can show that this K is almost always K lambda. So that if you integrate the length of any of this curve, the true metric in the true manifold, approaches the one that you would have computed between these two points in the Sitter metric. That is, starting late enough, take any curve, compute the length is the same up to an exponentially decaying constant factor, which becomes arbitrarily small, to the one of the Sitter space. Okay. So this means that for what concerns curves, in particular geodesics, the universe is the same as the Sitter space. But what about meta? Well, we can show that the integral, the meta, it doesn't go to zero everywhere, but on average it goes to zero. That is, the integral over the set of the volume, or since there are two-dimensional isometries, we care only of the z-integral, all up to trivial factors, of any component of the stress tensor, because of the dynamic energy condition, is less than the integral of the energy density rho, which is this quantity, decays like this, e to the minus fr k lambda lambda. So it decays, and such that even if one integrates over the spatial slices, this grows at most like e to the 1/3 k lambda square lambda, which is much less than how we grow in the Sitter space, because if it was everywhere, it would grow if it was constant. If it was this was constant, this would grow in the volume like e to the plus k lambda square lambda. So it decays much, it's almost everywhere, T mu nu goes to zero. Now, and in particular, this shows that in particular, one can make it more sophisticated, because the fact that T mu nu goes to zero almost everywhere might still allow for some local clumps of meta which are potentially observable. But with a little more of sophistication, we can do the following thing. We can really show physical equivalence to the Sitter over exponential balls. Because consider, for example, an observer. Within an exponential ball of himself, the metric is like the Sitter space. So the geodesics are the same as the Sitter space. And so he sees an horizon as in the Sitter space. So there is an horizon. So all the meta that he sees can come only from the past lichen of this horizon. So it's only a finite volume that can affect from time on this observer, the meta in this observer. But by taking this finite volume later and later enough, the overall meta that was in this finite volume actually was going to zero, okay? So the overall meta that can affect this point later and later in time goes to zero. But any physical experiment, perhaps because of quantum mechanics, will have some finite threshold, activation threshold. And in the whole matter that can affect this point, a certain observer, at some point has an energy below this threshold, energy and stress tensor, any composite stress which is below this threshold, so this experiment, any experiment cannot be activated. And therefore, this observer sees an empty space because matter cannot activate any experiment with the geodesic at the Sitter space. So for what concerns any experiment with the equivalence principle, it is equivalent to the Sitter space. Now, we don't show that the Riemann tensor is the same as the Sitter space. So so there is potentially some deviation from the Sitter space at this level, but these are for sure high energy effect, because the low energies, the equivalence principle is expected to hold, these are higher derivative terms. And so therefore there is equivalence to the city space in the low energy sense and long distances over arbitrary long distances, but smaller than the distances beyond causal connections, which remember the initial beginning of the universe. Now, due to lack of time, I wrote down the proofs, but there is no time for proof. I'm already way over time. So this is all I have to say, and the rest, given a long talk, would be just the mathematical proofs. Thank you very much for your attention. See you later. Bye.